Emma ducked and hurried toward the station, one hand on her hat, trying to remember where she saw her uncle. Suddenly, a strong hand closed over the handle of the suitcase and she turned, ready for a struggle. Percy smiled and pried the luggage from her grip. He tipped his top hat in her direction. His eyelashes were so light they were nearly invisible, and his hair was such a bright shade of blonde it looked white. "Hello, Emma," he said. "I'm sorry you've returned to Coal River under such sad circumstances, but it's so good to see you." She nodded once. "Percy," she said. Just then, a miner in a tattered coat broke through the police line and headed toward Uncle Otis, his face contorted with rage. A policeman caught him, wrapped an arm around his neck, and dragged him backward across the train platform. A second policeman hurried over to help, handcuffing the man's wrists behind his back. "What in the world is going on?" Emma said.
"Everyone is restless these days," Percy said. "It's the heat."
"But why are the miners throwing rocks at those men?" He glanced over his shoulder, as if noticing the disturbance for the first time.
"Those men are new immigrants," he said. "The miners think they're here to take their jobs."
He extended his elbow, asking permission to escort her through the crowd.
"Shall we?"
She lifted the hem of her skirt and reluctantly took his arm. "I suppose."
"You look exactly the same," he said. "That is, I mean to say, you look wonderful."
She gave him a thin smile and searched the faces of those around her to avoid his probing eyes. No doubt he was surprised she was still so small in stature, despite the fact that 9 years had passed since her last visit. She wondered how long it would be before he made fun of her for being so short. He ushered her through the crowd, using her suitcase to nudge people out of the way. Near the ticket window, Uncle Otis was talking with a policeman, his face red, his brow furrowed.
"Take down the names of anyone who gives you trouble," he said.
"Yes, Mr. Shawcross," the policeman said. "Father," Percy said, "look who's arrived."
Uncle Otis smiled and opened his arms.
"Welcome back, Emma," he said. "I'm sorry about your parents, but it's a pleasure to see you."
"Hello, Uncle," she said. She clenched her jaw and turned her cheek to let him hug her.
"My God, woman," he hissed in her ear. "Where is your mourning veil? Have you no decency?"
She drew away and gripped the edge of her handbag, twisting the drawstring between her fingers. "I removed my veil on the ride here," she said. "It was too cumbersome to wear the entire trip."
"Well, now that you've arrived," Uncle Otis said, forcing a smile, "you must put it back on before riding through town."
She shrugged. "I'm afraid that's impossible," she said. "The train was unearthly hot, and when I opened a window, the veil was sucked right out."
Uncle Otis frowned.
"I don't have time for this right now," he said. "I've got my hands full with these miners. Take her up to the house, Percy, then come back for me. Tell your mother to get her settled in."
"Yes, sir," Percy said.
Uncle Otis started to move away, then stopped and turned to face Percy again.
"Take the side roads," he said under his breath.